right, guys, welcome to another episode of They Tried to Bury Us. I'm Tamer Kattan, and only one more episode without Kitty Kattan. Mom, we miss you in Boston already. We'll see you back in L.A. Doing one more from the road. But I'm very excited to welcome to this guest, to this episode, a very special guest, my friend Chase Abel.
What's up, T?
Hey, Chase, how are you, brother?
TK. TKO.
That's right. TKO, I like that. TKO.
TKO.
Dude, Chase, I'm so happy to have you on the podcast because, like, when I first came to Boston, I was featuring for Adam Ray.
That's right.
At Laugh Boston.
That's right, yep.
And you were working there at the time.
It was. I was working at the, I was working as a front doorman. I was the senior security guard there.
I didn't know that. I thought you were, because you were so slick, I thought you were, like, one of the management guys.
That's what I do. I like to pretend what I'm not sometimes.
Hey, it's not just dress for the job you want. It's act like the job you want. Well, I like that.
Well, I always I've always been a part of me. You know, if you dress for, you know, the situation, you know, look like you know what you're doing.
Sure.
You know, even though you may not know what's going on, you could, you know, at least look like the part.
Like that. You know I think that's the thing we, especially when you're an immigrant and you come to America, that's something you learn, you know?
Yeah, ain't that the truth?
So you come from a country that I consider like a sister country to me. Your family immigrated from Eritrea.
Eritrea, that's right.
And where you were born there, like me, you were born in, I was born in Egypt, but you were born in Eritrea.
I actually, Tam, I was actually born in, in Sudan.
Oh, wow.
I was born in
another sister country. Shout out to Sudan.
Yeah. I was born in I was actually born in a refugee camp.
Oh, wow.
Yeah. So part of it was that back in the 80s and in 70s, pretty much the history is, like, you know, if people do not know, you know, Eritrea was going through a huge, like, civil war with Ethiopia at the time. Right. There was a huge war, and a lot of people fled, you know, due to the war. So they were taken, housing and stuff like that in refugee camps. And Sudan was, like, back then was housing a lot of Eritreans and Ethiopians, you know, fleeing their country. So,
So both sides were fleeing.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, both sides, yeah. So, and I was born in Khartoum. Sudan, the capital, I believe.
I know Khartoum, yeah.
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah. And we were there for a couple years in the refugee camps. And
a couple years.
Yeah, man. Waiting to come here.
Do you remember what the refugee camp was like, what the environment was like?
I to be honest with you, I don't. I was so young.
Yeah.
I was so young. I mean, I was like, you know, 2-3 years old.
Yeah.
You know. My memory, to be honest with you, really started when I came here.
Yeah.
As soon as, like, I remember coming here.
Yeah.
Which was, like, about 4.
I can relate to that.
Yeah, but nothing before that. I can't remember anything before that.
Yeah, I was, like, a different person when I was in Egypt. Like, when I think back of my childhood, I don't think, oh, that's younger me. I think, oh, that was different me.
Ah.
You know what I mean?
Okay, yeah, I could see that. Yeah.
Wow. So that must have been insanely hard for your folks, too, to be, like, we're trapped in this camp for...
I mean, it was all... I
imagine that was longer than they expected to be there.
Yeah. I mean, there's no... I mean, you can't really, I guess, back... I guess you can't... You couldn't really determine, like, the time of how long you're going to stay there.
Sure.
You know what I mean? But I guess, like, the plan was... I don't even know if their plan was to even essentially come here in the first place. Yeah. I do know that there were stories of... They just had to survive, dude.
Yeah.
They, you know, the first thing was just getting the fuck out of Eritrea.
You know, it's funny. One of my friends in America was talking about war, and I said, you don't know war. Because when you talk about going to war, it happens over there and far away from America. It's very rare that America gets to experience what war smells like or sounds like or tastes like. In Egypt, when war would happen, the ground would shake, even if you were living in a city away from the war.
Oh, yeah.
And I imagine that that's probably something you experienced, your family experienced, versus, you know, here we talk about war, and I think sometimes we jump to the conclusion that we should go to war without realizing what that actually means to people.
Yeah, it means a lot.
Yeah.
Ever since I was a kid, man, my parents never let me forget, you know, where we came from. Mm. You know what I mean? Every single sentence started when I was a kid.
Yeah, I can relate to that. Oh,
and you know, you're lucky to be here because, you know, there's people dying back home.
Wow.
You know, this, you know, what I'm talking about, man, when I talk about like really, you know, impoverished situations, man, you're talking about like, I mean, kids, you know, not having shoes, man.
Yeah.
You know, like good pair of shoes. You know, you think about it, right? The first thing that we do when we wake up in the morning, man, and to walk out that door, we have a good pair of shoes on.
That's right.
Because that carries us throughout the day.
You know, in Egypt, I remember I have a very vivid image of my grandmother yelling down at me from a balcony, "Tamer, come upstairs and put on shoes." And it was because I would play soccer with all the poor kids and none of them had shoes. So I took off my shoes and I'd go downstairs barefoot and I gave them all my socks and we would make a ball out of our socks.
Oh yeah.
And we played soccer with a ball made out of socks in the street and I'd run barefoot in the streets of Cairo. And I'd come home with bleeding feet, but I was the same as the other kids.
But she was the same.
Yeah.
Yeah. Everybody. It's like, it's weird because, you know, everyone is, you don't really think of yourself as like, I mean, you know, my friend talk about this all the time, like with Randy, like, you know, when you grow up poor, it's like, you don't, when you grow up with the same people who are poor, you don't really think you're poor.
Yeah.
You know, you just.
Oh, that's such a good point. You're right.
You're just there with people.
Yeah. Your environment is defined by the people around you.
Yeah.
So like, I'm not, everyone around me is the same as me. So I'm not poor.
Exactly.
I'm just like everybody else.
You know what I mean?
I'm normal.
It's like, hey, you know, go over to, you know, next door and go get some milk from, because you know, it's everyone shares.
Yeah.
Everyone's like, you know, so, but it was interesting because like my parents, like, I mean, my shit's weird, dude. Like my fucking life is weird. You know what I mean? Because like.
That's why you're here.
Yeah. Like I know like my dad, my parents, you know, they're Eritrean. My dad grew up in Ethiopia though.
Mm.
So he didn't grow up in Eritrea. He grew up in Ethiopia in the capital, Addis Ababa. And my mom grew up in Eritrea. So there's a lot of like our cultures, which is weird because Eritrea and Ethiopia are very, very similar.
Yeah.
But they're very, very different.
It's so common that the countries that are most similar end up fighting each other.
Yeah, man.
So weird.
It's so weird. And I think Eritrea and Ethiopia is one of the very complex like history, like, you know, groups of like. Sector of history like people really don't know about, but yeah. It's so rich in history, like, you know, like,
yeah. I mean, you guys look biblical to me.
They you know say it mean? All that's where it started, man.
When you look back at like illustrations from Bibles, the way that people looked, they looked Eritrean, they looked Ethiopian to me. I mean, I remember in Egypt in our living room we had a photograph of Anwar Sadat and King Haile Selassie from Ethiopia. And he was wearing his uniform and he still had the ring with the Lion of Zion.
Yeah.
He was still wearing it before he gave it to Bob Marley.
Mm-hmm.
And ever since, I mean,
he gave his ring to Bob Marley?
Yeah. You didn't know that?
I didn't know that.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And at the time, I was living in Egypt and I remember at the time I was born, my president was black. And his wife was a white English woman. And one of his good friends was the leader of Ethiopia.
Yeah.
And so I remember I didn't see color the way we see the kids who were born in America see color.
Yeah, that's foul.
It was, or I just saw color as like left-handed or right-handed. I didn't attach any prejudice to color. Do you know what I mean?
No, I do know.
I think my first three heroes were black.
Yeah,
like I didn't have like a hero that was white until I moved to America.
Until you moved to America, yeah, that's usually how
usually how it
goes. Like, yeah, man, it's weird because like, yeah, man, Eritrea and Ethiopia, I mean, it's so rich in history, man. And they do say that, you know, the very first people like originated from there. You know,
yeah.
I think it's I could be pronouncing the group of people wrong, but Oromo people, which is like, I could be wrong. I'm not really like,
yeah.
But
Egyptians are gonna say it was Egypt.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. I know.
Egypt, we say Omeldonia.
Omeldonia.
Omeldonia, which means mother of the world.
Yeah, yeah, man.
But you know what? I have this thing.
We're right there, though. We're next to each other, though.
There was a guy who yelled at God bless America at one of my shows, and I said, I hope he does, but you know what God would say if he heard you say that? He'd say, what's America?
Yeah.
And as far geographically, Egypt, Eritrea, Ethiopia, we're all in the same region.
It's all in the same region.
So those lines were not drawn by a creator or a god or a superpower. Those lines are ridiculous. They're all false.
False, yeah.
So essentially, we are countrymen. Yeah. You know, because whoever drew those lines had nothing to do with us.
Because you could, bro, if you came to Eritrea, you could look Eritrean.
Yeah.
Or Ethiopian. Yeah. You just look at, like, a lighter, you know what I mean? Like,
I believe it.
So we come in all different, like, shades and skin colors.
Same
and,
in Egypt.
You know what I mean? Our skin is, like, fucking dope. It's soft. It's, like, silky, you know, because we're Africans. We're
right
dope.
Right on.
I'm going to let you know, like,
right Africans, on. I love hearing we're dope. That.
Yes, everything sir. Came from Africa.
That's right.
You know what I mean? So, you know, the dominating gene is the DNA is the black gene.
I love it.
You know what I mean? So let's just get that out the way. You know, people that say, well, you know, no.
Yeah.
Like, it came from Africa, starting with Africa. Right. And it probably will end in Africa if shit goes to fucking heck. goes to shit.
I don't doubt it.
You know what I mean?
I think it's really fun. I had a guy, I had a conversation with me. He was talking about the potential of India and the potential of China. Now, these are amazing superpowers. And I'm like, you know what? Really, the continent that has the most potential is Africa. The resources we have, the talent we have, all the people we have. I had a friend say, oh, it's a bummer about terrorism because when terrorism happens, it kills tourism, and tourism is Egypt's most valuable resource. And I go, you're wrong. Egypt, not just Egypt, but Africa's most valuable resource is talent. And what happens is because our governments are so corrupt in Africa, the talent leaves. So the most talented people from Africa make America better. They make England better. They make all the Western countries better because we leave our country because the corruption is so bad. And that's why we need to pay attention to the corruption that's happening in America and make sure that it doesn't reach a level where we're not America anymore.
Yeah, man.
You know?
But I would say resiliency is our thing.
Yeah.
Africans.
Yeah.
Or, you know, a little bit more than talent, in my opinion, because, you know, if you don't, you know, there's a lot of talented people that we know.
Yeah.
But a lot of times it just stops and then they, you know, people get lazy.
Yeah.
You know, people, they don't have that drive.
Yeah.
You know, they don't, because whatever, they're pretty much just like, you know, yeah, I'm doing all right. You know, like,
yeah.
But if you don't have resiliency, like, you know.
100%.
It's like, you know, because.
It's the silver lining of having a tough upbringing is that it gives you strength.
Yeah, man.
I think human beings are a lot like cacti. The less you give them, the stronger we get. But if you overwater them, they get soft. And I think human beings are like that.
Oh, yeah.
So speaking of resilience, so you guys are in this refugee camp in Ethiopia.
Yeah.
Sudan. Oh, in Sudan, I'm sorry.
Yeah.
Sorry.
Yeah.
So you're in a refugee camp in Sudan.
Yeah.
How do you go from there to America?
Dude, so how it goes is, you know, so pretty much my dad's working my mom is, you know, working, and I have to be kind of like, okay, so I'm going to let you know I was raised not by my biological parents.
Oh.
So.
I didn't know this.
When I say my dad and my mom, they're not my biological parents.
Mm-hmm.
So I was raised by my mom's sister, which is technically my aunt.
Yeah.
And my biology and my dad, who I call my dad, is the husband of my aunt.
Wow, okay.
So because my real dad, my biological dad, I don't know him. I never met him. The story is he left me when I was like 10 days old. He came, you know, like when I was born, he stayed, like he had like another wife and like kids, and then, you know, he met my mom, you know, had me, left to go back to the, you know. And then my mom, like, had me. She stayed around for a little bit with my parents.
Yeah.
And then she left. So I never was raised, like, with my biological parents.
Wow.
So, but, you know, but at a time, we were all together, though, in this refugee camp. So it was like, but, you know, I think my mom, like, just knew, like, her sister didn't have the app to raise me. Like, she just wasn't there.
She knew her sister would take better care of you.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. So she just gave her to me. But we're waiting, man. And we're just like, we're waiting to get sponsored. We got sponsored by a white couple here.
You're kidding.
Yeah, man. We were sponsored by a white couple. I remember their name till this day, Harvey and Kathy.
Wow.
Yeah.
This is so interesting. So you're in a refugee camp and white people or Americans could sponsor you and bring you into the country to take you out of the refugee camp.
Yeah, they take the friggin'.
Wow.
Yeah, just.
That's so amazing.
They're from, yeah, they brought us over, man. I think they were part of a church or, you know, where they sponsored people, you know, and then they brought us here, man. So if it wasn't for white people, I wouldn't fucking be here.
That's awesome.
Yeah. Like, I you know, and I kind of talk about that a little bit. Like, you know, because, you know, people fucking, you know, this whole, especially the time that we're in right now, you know, it's like, I always try to tell people, especially people of color, you know, it's like, dude, like, not everyone's fucking the same, dude.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Like,
skin color has very little to do with who you are.
Skin color has very little to do with who you are. Unfortunately, you know, it's in this country, it's, you know, it's defined a little differently. But, yeah, man, they were fucking great, man. They fucking brought us in, dude. I remember it was Lynn, Mass, man. That was where they live.
Lynn, Massachusetts?
Lynn, Massachusetts.
What's Lynn, Mass like?
Back then, it was a bunch of, like, it was tough, bro. It was, like, it was very Spanish heavy, like, populated, like, it was rough. Like, it was Latinos, it was blacks, it was, like, it was not, like, a great area to live in
the 80s. These were white people who kind of lived in the barrio. The white people who lived in a Latino and African-American community and brought you guys in from the refugee camp. Yeah,
we lived with them. And they gave, you know, and we got a little help. You know what I'm saying? The guy that brought Harvey, I remember he was in the military, but he also worked at GE, which was like across the street where his house was. Wow. So he, you know, I think he was in the reserve or he was a military guy, but he also worked at GE, Airlines or something like that, which is also still in Lynn. He would work overnights and he would, you know, stay during the day.
Yeah.
And then I would remember my parents, like, you know, I don't know what they would do. Like, I do know, like, my mom, her education was, like, she didn't really have, like, a high school education at all. I think my mom has, like, a, you know, she came with, like, probably, like, a seventh, eighth grade education.
Yeah.
But she's just started cleaning houses, man. Like, she's just got, like, white people, rich white people's houses, like, in the Hunt and Marblehead. These are, like, kind of, like, affluent areas.
Yeah.
Like, outside of Boston, just suburbs, like, beach houses and, like, near the beaches.
Yeah.
And I remember she would take me as a kid to clean the houses.
Wow.
So I learned work ethic very, very early.
And you got, it must have been so crazy for you as a kid to watch your mom doing work and then look at this house and be like, wow, look how these people live.
Oh, bro.
Right.
You know what's crazy? You just said that, man.
Hmm.
So sometimes, like, for a little bit of living, you know, I drive, like, Lyft.
Mm.
You know what I'm saying? Like, I, you know, like, Uber or whatever.
Sure.
Yeah, and I picked one woman up. Like, this was, like, last week. I swear to God, this is crazy how this is, like, coming together. So she's like, yeah, you know, and I saw the address. It's Nahant. You know, Nahant. And I remember Nahant as a kid. And I haven't been back there since as a kid.
Wow.
And I was just telling them, you know, she was an artist, actually. She was an artist. She was renting, like, a studio apartment. And she was telling me, you know, how it is over there. It's very, like, you know, it's very white. I mean, there's no minorities over there whatsoever. It's, like, very, very, like...
How do you spell it?
Nahant. N-A-H-A-N-T.
Okay, Nahant.
Nahant, yeah. So, and it's a very little community just, like, along the beach, you know, like, which is just, like, next to Revere. It's, like, it's outside of Boston, probably, like, 40 minutes.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm sharing this story about me. Like, this is just me. I'm just telling my fucking story to strangers, you know, in a car. Yeah. Like, I'll talk to anyone.
Yeah, hey, when I mean? Comics drive, we want to talk.
Yeah. I'll talk to anyone, dude.
Yeah.
Yo, so I'm telling her, man, I'm like, yeah, I remember a specific house that my mom used to clean, and still it resonates to me today. All I know, it was a house, like, it was kind of a flat. It was on a huge hill, and it looked over the water, the ocean, and it had a hammock. And I always would just sleep on the hammock when my mom would clean when I finished. And I would just remember we would go there like once every couple weeks. And that was my memory of this house. And I was telling her, she goes, I think I know the house you're talking about.
Get out.
I swear to God. She's like, I think I know the house you're talking about. She's like, before you drop me off, let's go see. She actually was like, let's go see it. Because the community's really small, man.
Wow.
It's like a... Like
how
a,
cool of her.
She's dope. Oh, she's an artist, man.
To be like, hey,
she was
let's
also
go
white.
That's very cool of her to say, hey, let's go have this experience together. You know, forget my ride for a second. You know, it's funny because sometimes we're in such a rush to do things. It's the epitome of let's stop and smell the roses, right? She, instead of trying to get to her destination, she's like, what a cool story this guy's telling me. And I have the ability to make the story even more special.
Oh, she was so dope.
Let's go do this thing.
Yeah.
Shout out to her.
She's so dope. I forgot her name, but she smelled like lavender.
Of course she did.
She had that.
Every female artist always smells like lavender.
Yeah. I'm a big fan of lavender. But
what a kind thing.
It was.
For her to say, I think I know this house. Let's go see it.
Yeah. And I was like, all right, let's do it. And then we just started driving. Things are starting to come together. I haven't been there in like over 30 years, dude.
Wow.
You know what I mean? And I'm thinking, oh, we're not going to find it. And as soon as like we turn the corner, we're up on the hill. And it looks over the ocean. And you can look at like, I see the fucking house. And the hammock is still there.
Wow. Oh, my God.
The hammock is still there.
What did you feel like when you saw that?
I felt a sense of, like, serenity.
Yeah.
To be honest with you.
Yeah.
Like I'm still getting, like, a little shivers right now because a lot of my dreaming started there.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Like, I've always was attracted to water. Mm. You know what I mean? A lot of my early days of just dreaming started on that hammock.
Water probably associated with you with a sense of safety and calm, and you know this neighborhood where you can exhale.
Yeah, every time I had issues, man, I go to water.
Wow.
Every time I had like problems, man, like I grew up pretty. My history is like really interesting, but like every time I had an issue, man, I would just water. You know, wow. I'd ride my bike to the beach.
You know, me too. You want to hear a crazy thing my therapist said to me?
What?
He said the reason why people feel a sense of calm when they watch the sunset on a beach or on a lake, whatever, is because when you're watching the sunset on a beach, you're staring out at nothing. It's empty. And you realize how small you are. And when you realize how small you are, by association, your problems feel smaller too.
Ah, yeah. I can see that.
And so there's an attraction to that. I never thought about this before, but there's an attraction to sunsets. It's not at the actual sun setting, but it's the realization that you are small.
Okay.
And that you are, and by association, that your problems are small. You know, it makes you realize our place in the world, that we're just a blip.
Oh yeah.
We're just a tiny blip.
We're very minuscule.
Yeah.
To what actually really goes on every single day.
So when you got there, did she ask you what happened when you got there?
We made out and then
get out. No, are you serious?
I'm just kidding.
You made it. Oh man, what a bummer, man! I got so excited. That was good. No, man. But, that was good.
I was like, I mean, what else would there be else to do over there? You know. But no, man. I just looked at it, man. I'm like, and I knew exactly it was the house because I remember the hammock. I remember the layout of the backyard.
Yeah.
I remember it was a flat type of house.
Amazing.
Yeah, man. And we looked at it and we went around, and I dropped her at her place because I had to by law, and and I left, man. But as I was leaving, I'm like, wow, man. It's like you never know, like when things come back.
Yeah,
you know, you can be like, and especially now, man. Like, you know, comedy, like, you know, as comedians, man, we're like, we can. It's easier for us to kind of forget, like. You know, because we're always hustling, man.
Yeah.
You know, we're always hustling to the next thing.
Yeah.
You know, and we don't really, like, kind of, you know, enjoy the moment because, you know, we have to get to this next audition. We have to get up at a mic or a show. We got to email a booker. We got to, you know.
Yeah.
You know, always fighting, man. Always fighting.
It's very future-facing.
Yeah.
Instead of being present.
Yeah.
You're right.
And so, yeah, man, it was good to kind of, like, just, you know, I always, to be honest with you, man, I've always been, like, a type of dude that's, like, unconsciously, subconsciously, just thought differently from most people. And a lot of it's because of my immigrant.
Yeah.
You know.
It changes you. It changes you to witness the things that you witnessed.
Yeah.
You know, to be here. And it makes you, it aggressively forces you to be appreciative. You know what I mean?
Especially when you got parents, like, you know, like telling you in front of your face. Like,
yeah.
You know, like. You know,
so then you moved here. This family sponsored you.
Yeah.
And so it's almost like you guys are two families living in one household.
Yeah. Yeah.
And then at what point was there a point where you guys detached?
Of course. Yeah. Yeah. So they gave us a little time to live with them. My dad got a job, like really quickly. And he learned English like really quickly.
Yeah.
Like, you know, and my mom learned English very quickly. You know, that's another thing too. Like now people say, you know, this whole immigrant thing now and all this thing about, you know, all this stuff that's happening with immigrants. I'm like, dude, like the ones that really come here and they don't play around, dude. We don't fucking play around, bro. Like, dude, you know what I mean?
We're
coming to make it.
I told this racist guy, I said, if you don't like immigrants, what you need to realize is the immigrants that you're meeting, these are the best of what we have. The immigrants you're meeting are the best people
yeah.
from those countries. They are the hardest working. They are the most driven.
Yeah.
They are the most, in my mind, if, when I'm searching for an adjective, the adjective I always grasp towards is American. They are the most American of immigrants. The people, because it's not just about what where people that are made in America, it's made about people that are made of America.
Yeah.
We have more in common with the founding fathers than anybody who was born in this country. Because it's a characteristic, it's a personality trait. It's not a geographic trait, it's a personality trait that makes you say, I see this opportunity for a better life in another country,
yeah.
and I'm willing to leave everyone I know,
oh, yeah.
everything I know, to entirely deconstruct my foundation.
Language,
culture, family. I'm leaving everything in order to chase an opportunity in another country. That has nothing to do with where you're born. It has everything to do with your spirit.
Oh, yeah.
It's the spirit.
100%, man.
And I say this repeatedly, it doesn't matter who's made in America, it matters who's made of America. And what you're saying about your parents is they were very much made of America.
Oh, I agree, man. I mean, my dad, he grew up with like not a father either, like, you know, and he had to raise his brothers as a kid. So
what's up with the retreat with these cats taking off?
You know what it is, man?
I love a retreat. Don't get me wrong. I have a ton of respect for retreat. Shout out to like the Tiffany Haddishes of the world.
Hell yeah.
The Nipseys of the world.
R.I.P.
You guys have some amazing talent.
Nate Burhey, who's the first Eritrean American in the NFL playing currently.
You guys are top of the food chain entertainers and top of the food chain cultural leaders in America. Yeah. And I don't think a lot of people realize that Tiffany Haddish is Eritrean, mm-hmm. that Nipsey was Eritrean,
The Weeknd is Ethiopian.
Yeah. Like a lot of people, sometimes when they come up, they don't wave that flag as big as they can. But shout out to Tiffany Haddish for wearing national dress at the Oscars.
Yeah, she did, man.
Right, she wore the Eritrean national dress at the Oscars. Yeah, with right
the
on.
Kadane, they call or the yeah, it's a traditional, the traditional woman's dress.
That's dope.
Yeah,
that makes me love Tiffany Haddish that much more.
She's I've never met her. I mean, I know mutual people that know her. Mm. And she's, you know, one day hopefully I will be, you know, hopefully like to meet her. And
I just met her a couple times. Stories. I wish I would have known she was Eritrean before I met her.
Oh.
Because we would have had more to talk about. Wow. But I met her at Laugh Factory one night, and then I met her at JFL, at the Just for Last Festival in Montreal, yeah. when she won Comedy Person of the Year.
Okay.
And I'll never forget it, because Kevin Hart flew in by private jet just to hand Tiffany the award himself.
The award himself.
He wanted to hand her the award. And here's the crazy part. Is Tiffany, she goes, wait, Kevin. She says, before you introduce me, I have a present for you. And she gave him these tiny pair of high tops. It looked like children's high tops, which was really funny.
Yeah.
And everybody laughed because Kevin Hart's so petite.
Sure.
But then Kevin reached in the high tops and there was $300 cash.
That he... Oh,
exactly.
I know that
and
story.
Then Kevin Hart said, he's all, see what she's doing right here? See what she's doing? She's trying to pay me back in front of white people so I can't throw it in her face. She said, but a long time ago when Tiffany was coming up, yeah. I had to let her borrow $300. And ever since then, she's been trying to pay me back.
Yeah.
And he keeps telling her no, and she keeps trying to give him the money. And it made me even that much more respect for her. You know, because talk about a tough childhood. My God, you know, between, you know, coming up in the neighborhood she came up in, coming up with a parent that had mental health issues, mm-hmm. to she's always someone that I said, not only did she reach the top of comedy, but she's someone that I know will never forget how lucky she is and how fortunate she is, and to have gratitude for what she got. And to see her on the biggest stage you can be on in comedy and receiving the award for Comedy Person of the Year and to still trying to be paying Kevin Hart back $300.
Yeah, man.
Is like shout out to her and shout out to where she came from.
I have a list of all the people that I owe money to, and once I do make it big, I do plan to give each one of them back.
That's great, man. That's great.
Eritreans, man, we're like Eritreans, you know, Ethiopians as well. We're very humble, like, we're people, and we're very, like, you know, hospitable people, and we're very prideful people at the same time. Mm. You know, and we're it's not about us.
Yeah.
First, it's about you.
Yeah.
You know, if you come into the house, it's like, you know, we're going to give you, like, tea. We're going to feed you.
Yeah.
You know, we're going to the beginning, to the end.
You want to hear something crazy?
Yeah.
So in the neighborhood that I lived in Egypt, we lived in an area called Zemalek.
Zemalek, yeah.
And it was across from this famous country club called Nadi El Shams.
Did you speak Arabic?
Yeah. Fluent.
I used to speak Arabic.
Really?
Fluently.
Wow.
As a kid, when I came, but I lost it, unfortunately, when I came here. Man.
I claim to speak Arabic fluently, but I have a very thick American accent, oddly.
Yeah.
And they laugh at me because I left Egypt when I was 8, so I still speak like an 8-year-old. So when I think I'm saying, excuse me, where's the restroom?
Yeah.
Waiters let me know that I just said, excuse me, I have to go pee-pee.
Waiters are judgmental in Africans.
But I'll never forget this, dude. There was a family that was from Ethiopia, and I think they were Eritrean originally, but they came through Ethiopia into Egypt. And
I thought you said they just changed to be Ethiopian.
No, they came through Ethiopia.
It's like, oh, I was Eritrean, but, well, fuck it. It's going to be Ethiopian now.
But I mean, I grew up eating a lot of Ethiopian food with that sour bread. And we eat
Injada.
Food. Injada. And we eat food the same way. Where my mom still gets mad at me because I'm old school. Yeah. I eat my food with bread. I don't eat fork and knife. Yeah. I tear up my pita bread and I use it to scoop
it's
the
like
food.
It's like teff.
Exactly.
Yeah.
And I grew up with a lot of Ethiopians in my neighborhood and Eritreans. And we used to scoop bread that way, and I love that sour bread. Mm. And
very thin, like a crepe almost.
Exactly. Even it's like a crepe, and it looks like there's like air bubble holes in it. And I remember this Eritrean family via Ethiopia was in Egypt, and they bought me when they knew I was coming back to Egypt to visit.
Yeah,
because I went to Egypt during the revolution. I went to Egypt during the revolution to perform comedy at the American University in Cairo, to perform comedy for the protesters.
Wow.
And it was wild. A guy actually tried to stab me. Long story, but different podcast episode.
I believe it, yeah.
But the Eritrean family had bought me this dessert that was extremely... It was called basbousa. And basbousa means like kiss. In Arabic, means kiss. And it's like a semolina, like pastry with like honey and this almond on top. And it's extremely expensive. And they hadn't seen me since I was 4 years old.
Oh, they were probably so happy.
And they were so happy to see me. They took me into their apartment and they had a picture of me on their wall from when I was 5 years old, knowing that I now live in America. And whenever my mom had posted things on Facebook, they had printed out the pictures from Facebook and cut it out and put it on their wall. And I knew that the dessert that they bought was expensive. But my mom said, do you know that that dessert they bought you was like a week's salary? And it devastated me.
Yeah.
I had this really mixed emotion of like, oh, that's so nice, and guilt. I felt a tremendous amount of guilt.
We are a very, very giving culture, yeah. Man.
Could you imagine?
No, I can. To the point where we don't think about ourselves.
That's exactly right.
It outweighs like our own personal, like, you know.
Yeah.
Like, you know.
I felt guilty as shit.
Yeah.
I felt guilty as shit to the point where I tried, you know, it's funny that Tiffany Haddish was trying to give Kevin Hart that money because I tried and tried and tried to pay them back in some way.
Yeah.
And they refused.
Yeah.
At every turn.
We wouldn't do it.
They refused to take any money from me in any way, shape, or form.
Even if, you know, knowing the fact that they're like poor, like, and that money could help them.
Yeah,
we still wouldn't take it.
And in Egypt too, in Egypt, when you transfer your money from American dollars to Egyptian pounds, if you go back and say, "Here's the Egyptian pounds, could I have American dollars?" they won't do it. They're like, "No, just keep the Egyptian pounds." Mm. They refuse. So Egyptian, American dollars worth a lot. A lot out there, and they just refused. They wouldn't take it, and I was struggling. I it messed up part of my trip because I kept thinking about them and going, I have to pay them back in some way.
Yeah.
I have to.
Yeah.
And eventually I did, but shout out to them for being so amazing and so like loving and kind and sweet. And even though I hadn't seen them since I was a child, to me, I was family.
Oh yeah.
I was family 100%. And it just, it's so humbling. It's so humbling to like see these people that I only remembered from photos when I was 4 years old, and to go back in my late 30s and to see them treating me just like family, and to be like, oh my God, they're treating me like family when I treated them just like pictures, people in pictures.
Yeah.
And now they're family to me again.
Because, yeah, man, that's a great thing I love about, like, you know, my culture and, like, you know, just even Africans in general, especially like Northeast Africa. Like, you don't have to be blood to be considered a family.
Thank you for shouting out Northeast Africa, by the way.
Yeah, man. That's
that includes Egypt. Yeah.
Includes Egypt, man. It's all that shit. Everything runs through that. What I'm saying is, like, I can go anywhere in the world, Tamer. And this is the God honest truth. Mm-hmm. I have people I can reach out to every part of the world. The community. I can go and say, hey, I'm coming into town.
Yeah.
My mom will probably know her cousin that they grew up in Eritrea.
Crazy.
And I can stay at their house.
That's amazing.
I can go anywhere. What I'm saying, Germany, Sweden, Italy, Eritrea, Egypt.
That makes sense.
You know, LA, it doesn't. There's Eritreans everywhere. Ethiopians everywhere. Because
you guys went through a civil war.
We went through a civil war, so we just scattered to wherever we can get asylum.
Yeah,
you know. So we're all, you know, we're just all over the world.
And
man.
We connect. Human beings connect by struggle. And I've mentioned this on another episode where I used to go with my dad to chemotherapy, and there was a black man that was there getting chemotherapy, but his kids lived far away, and he wasn't a great dad, he admitted to me, and that's why his kids weren't there. So I used to always hang out and tell them jokes during chemo.
Yeah.
And then when my dad died, this guy still had 3 more weeks, George, shout out to George, what's up, George? And I kept going out, and I kept hanging out with him, and at the end of it, he said, you know, you and your dad made me dizzy.
Yeah.
And I'm like, how do you mean? And he goes, all my life, I'm a black American. And when I see other black people, I know that they understand my struggle. So when I saw another black person, I'd acknowledge them with a head nod or what's up.
Yeah.
Because they knew the source of my greatest struggle. But then I got cancer. And I went from being an African American to being a cancer American. And now your dad is more my brother and you are more my son than anyone with the same skin color as me.
Yeah.
And I was like, wow.
It's, man, it's deep, bro. You know what I'm saying? It's like, it's really deep. And
you guys going through a civil war together.
For years.
It makes sense.
Since the 60s.
Since the 60s. It makes sense that the bond is so strong that even if you're someone who's unfamiliar to them, but you're still an Eritrean, that they look at you and say, come and stay. You can stay with us.
Stay.
You can stay with us. Stay with us in this city. Stay with us in this state.
Yeah.
You're one of us.
You know, if I'm a guest that's visiting, you know, the natural thing to do for us, we pay for everything.
Mm.
You know, if we're going out to dinner, we're paying for you because you're a guest.
Yeah.
You know, it's a very giving thing. You know what I mean?
So let me ask you this. You're in America now, you're staying with this family, your family's finding their way out and finding their own feet and building their own foundation. What was the toughest time for you? What was the most difficult period as someone immigrating from one culture, very rich and intense culture, coming into another culture? I mean, how difficult must have been to find your way into a new culture.
Mm-hmm.
Like, what was the toughest time for you?
The toughest time, I mean, you know, obviously, you know, I guess in the beginning, I was probably just like any other kid. You know, I went to an all, you know, I was only like one of the very few black kids in like, you know, elementary school, preschool.
It's wild.
I really wasn't, there was no one that looked like me, you know. I didn't really like my name. You know, like, so
Chase?
Yeah. Well, Chase is actually a nickname. Yeah.
What was your name?
Abel's my first name.
Abel is your first name.
Yeah, Abel's Abel.
Why did you, all these years, you didn't tell me that?
I don't know, man.
I like Abel.
Yeah.
You didn't like it?
In the beginning, I didn't like it. Because just because everyone was named, like, you know, Adam and Keith and, you know, all the girls like these dudes.
This is a strong drive to fit in when you're young.
Yeah. And
I get that.
And I was a really chubby kid. I was really bullied because, I was called Buoy, you know?
Buoy?
Yeah, that was my, because I was fat.
And, like a buoy, like, in the water?
In the water, you know? Like
bastards.
Yeah, and I always had to grow up, like, fighting, you know? Like, yeah. My early stages weren't easy. But, you know, I was into sports, man. Sports is what really gave me a fucking, I'm sorry, I didn't mean to swear. But
you can swear.
But it gave me a sense of structure.
Sure.
You know, I played sports. I was an athlete. The very hardest thing was probably like when I was 12, 13. And that's the time when my parents actually told me that I wasn't their biological kid.
Wow. So you didn't know?
I didn't know.
You didn't know that your parents were your biological parents?
I didn't know until I was turning 13.
Wow.
12, 13 years old.
Wow.
Which is obviously the greatest time, right? As you go into puberty, you're going through all these emotions.
Oh my God, it's like your foundation being ripped from underneath you.
Yeah, man. And just, you know, I just remember, man, just like, imagine being told the whole time that you're part of something.
Oh my God.
That you think you're part of something, and then you're told that it's not the case.
Oh my God. I can't even imagine.
And that's really where my life actually changed, like 100%.
Oh, I can imagine.
You know?
What was the motivation for them to tell you at that age?
They
had to do it at some point.
They weren't gonna. Mm. They weren't going to. They were really pressured to do it.
Mm.
This is the thing. The story is, my mom was pressured, like, by my grandmother and, like, her sister.
Mm.
Because they're like, you know, he's got to know.
Yeah.
You know, at some point, he's got to know.
You got to know your history.
He's got to know. But my dad's like, he was like, he's kind of a smart dude. He's like, listen, man, don't tell him now. Like, he's doing good in school. He's doing good in athletics.
Yeah.
If you tell him now, it's going to mess him up.
Yeah.
You know, he's not going to,
you're already going through a lot.
Wait until he graduates to college. Sure. Or, like, wait till, like, all the stuff he can get through.
You know what? I agree with him.
And my mother didn't listen. She felt guilty. She told him. And a lot of what he said happened.
Wow.
I just lost focus of school. I wasn't.
Dude, your foundation was ripped from underneath you.
Yeah.
For anyone who can't imagine your parents coming up to you and saying, hey, we're not your actual parents.
Yeah.
We are your adoptive. I mean, and here's the thing. Of course, when we're older and more mature, we realize that there's a difference between a mother and a mom and a father and a dad. And there's a difference between the people who biologically give birth to you, but the people who actually raise you. Mm-hmm. The people who raise you are your real family. That's your real family, 100%.
Yeah.
But it isn't, the experience you went through isn't as common to have a handoff happen. It happens in a loving way. It happens in a caring way. But whenever you are a smaller percentage of something that happens, it rocks you. It rocks you to feel like an outsider. I mean, you must have... It must have been like Sandra Bullock in that movie when she started floating in space.
It was just a... It was a tough time, man.
I can imagine.
It was a tough time because my mother... by that time, she brought... My real mother had came from Africa now.
Wow.
So she was living in Africa. I never met her, like, at all.
Yeah.
And the funny thing is, she was...
You didn't even know she existed.
I didn't know she existed, but she was living with us because when she first came here, she was living with us for a little bit. So this whole time, I thought she was my aunt.
Oh, shit.
So she
Okay, so now, okay, this adds a whole other layer of complexity. So your mom was there. Your mom had come there and stayed with you guys, and you thought, oh, this is just another relative, not knowing she was your actual mother.
Yeah.
Oh, my God.
Yeah, man.
How long did that happen?
She was probably living with us probably, because, when you first come from Africa, you don't have money, so you got to stay with family.
Sure.
So she probably stayed in probably for like maybe a year.
And then did you notice anything? Did you feel anything?
That's the thing. I didn't notice anything, man, because the thing is, when you grow up thinking like everything is normal with your normal family.
Yeah.
And this is why I tell people the power of love is so powerful.
Yeah.
Because there's no color. There's no, like,
that's right.
There's no group, you know? If you feel it, you just feel like you're part of it, you know?
Yeah.
The whole time, like, my brothers, I always just thought, like, they are my brothers, but I didn't even think, like, but the thing is.
But they are.
But they do, like, if you think about it, like, biologically, like, we do look different. But I never thought, in my
did
mind.
Did you not notice
I did
before?
Not notice.
I'm glad you didn't.
I just did not notice. Because
they are your brothers.
I just not
notice. It doesn't matter. It doesn't matter that you look a little different than they do.
I did not notice, man. It's I'm crazy. Glad. Like, it's just people, even when people was like, oh, you guys, I didn't, number one, I just was like, oh, that's my brother. Like, you know, like, because my brother's light skin, they have curly hair.
Yeah.
But it's like.
So your brothers look like me.
They look like you. without the hair, you know?
Yeah.
But. Yeah, man, isn't that crazy, bro?
That is absolutely crazy. I mean, dude, that's foundation rattling.
You mentally, know? Mentally messed me up like a lot.
Of course, of course.
All the way to at least my mid 20s.
In what way? How did it change? How do you think it made you different as a person?
Oh, it shaped it. That.
Do you have a hard time trusting people?
Yeah, huge.
Yeah,
I have a hard time trusting people from that.
Because, what about romantic relationships?
That too.
Yeah.
That too. Because how I rationalized it was, if I can't trust the most personal people in my life,
yeah,
how can I trust anybody else?
Yeah. And they didn't do anything wrong. They were actually trying to protect you.
That's the thing.
They're trying to protect you, but at the same time, it makes you feel like you don't know who to trust.
I don't know who to trust, man.
It's a fucked up situation.
Yeah.
It's a tough situation.
Even till now, like, relationships, I don't know. I had one major girlfriend, dude, my whole life, man. When I was, like, 22. You know, you always have that one.
100%.
I've never had a serious relationship, bro.
It's heartbreaking, dude. I'm the same way. I'm 48 years old. 48 years old.
Yeah.
And I feel bad for my girlfriend. I feel bad for her. The longest relationship I've ever had in 48 years has been a little over a year.
Yeah.
And I feel bad for her. I try my best to be a good boyfriend.
Yeah.
But I am like a rescue animal.
Yeah, yeah.
Where it's hard for me.
It's hard, man.
It's hard to trust.
It's hard to trust, man. Yeah. And I'm starting to get a comedy. I feel like, man, if I didn't have comedy, man, it's starting to help me with that.
I agree. Me too.
I started comedy late. You know, I started comedy late. I started in my 30s.
Yeah.
You know? Even though I don't really believe there's no real, you know, late time, really. But
I agree.
You come to it when you come to
it. I started at 40.
Yeah, man. So, you know. Yeah. So, but yeah, man, it was a tough time, bro. There was fights with my mom and my other mom. You know, there was like.
Was that the toughest time, do you think, for you in America when you were.
They took guardianship over me, bro. That's how bad it got.
Wow.
Legally. Like, you know what I mean? Like, there were times we were fighting, like, because, you know, they had to legally, like.
Were they fighting over you?
Yeah.
Oh, wow.
Yeah. Always. Yeah.
So after being about in America, she wanted you back. She wanted to say, I'm his mom.
I think so. Yeah. Wow. She wanted to, like, come back into the picture, you know? I went to stay with her for a little bit and I was 12 years old, man. You know, it was funny because she's like, "Oh, I'll give you your own room." I was like, "Oh, you give my own room? Okay, I'll live with you." That's how stupid I was. You know, like 11 years old.
You're just a kid.
You're just a kid. But like, my mom was like devastated. Like, she's like, "You know,
that must have been so confusing for you."
I was just confused, bro. I was just confused. I don't know what's going on. I had a sister too. She had another kid.
Oh my god.
And I had my sister was there. I didn't even know she was my sister until like they told me at that time.
Yeah.
So from like 12, man, but again, I still fought, man. I still, you know, I played sports. Sports was like the only thing that really, like, really calmed me down was sports, man. You know, I was a triathlete. Like, I played basketball, football, track, baseball. So I had to be one of the reasons why my mom always till this day, she's like, you never want to stay in the house because I was like, because I don't want, it's chaos.
Yeah.
I want out. I want, like, you know, that's why I look comfort for other people.
Dude, that's friends, so funny. I was the same way.
You know, I consider friends my family.
Yeah, me too.
You know,
my chosen family. It got to the point with me where it was so funny because I remember, I don't know if this was like a cultural thing, but there was these neighbors of ours. They were really, really nice people. They had a dog. It was this little petite dog, short dog with no tail, and he looked like those little British lap dogs.
Yeah.
Like a corgi, it was like that kind of, and they called it Bugsy Malone. That was a, they called the dog Bugsy. And it was a young couple on our street. Everybody else had kids. And so these two didn't have kids. It was just the two of them. And they had the dog Bugsy. And they were younger than everybody else. So all the kids on the street thought they were cool. And these two, they were complimenting me.
Okay.
And they told my dad, they're like, oh, Tamer is such a fun kid. He loves being out here. He loves being out on the street and having fun with these kids. And when we got home, my dad started yelling at me. And he said, see, they said you love being in the street. You need to study more.
Yeah.
You need to be all you care about is making people laugh. All you care about is running around being a clown. You can't make money. You can't make a living being a clown.
Yeah.
Isn't that funny? I'm a comedian now.
My dad was the same way, dude.
Yeah.
My dad was strict, bro. My dad played no games. And he had no problem putting his hands on me, too.
Yeah, mine, too. Mine used to beat the shit out of
me. Yo, man, I'm talking about, like, you know, I'm not saying I'm not categorizing him as abusive. Definitely he wasn't, like, abusive. Yeah. But there were times where, like, he was definitely verbally. Like, yeah. I was afraid of him because he'd get, you know, he'd yell, you know. Yeah. And there were times where he put his hands on me and the shit, like, it was bad, bro.
Yeah,
there were times too. That were bad, you know. And that's just, I guess, Africa, you know, just it's a different, you know.
Africa's different.
Africa's different, you know.
They almost feel like they'd be a bad dad if they didn't hurt you.
Yeah.
My dad was a boxer, and when he'd hit me like he was hitting a grown man, you know. Like, he'd hit me. I remember I was afraid of his ring because his ring would, when his ring hit me, it would hit extra hard.
Yeah.
I'll tell you a crazy story. One time my dad gave me a black eye.
Yeah.
And then he went to work, and both my parents went to work, and I remember the look on his face. He was shocked by how hard he hit me.
Yeah.
And he felt bad. But my dad never would say sorry. He would just start being nice.
My dad never said sorry.
Never said sorry.
African men don't say sorry.
They don't say sorry. They just start being nice after as a way to apologize.
Or they ignore you.
Exactly. Exactly. So then my dad went to work, and I was home alone, and my eyes started puffing up, and I got embarrassed. I'm like, I got to hide this. So I went in my mom's bathroom, and I found makeup, and I put foundation on my eye.
Yeah.
And then I got to school, and these kids are like, he's wearing makeup. What a homo. And then they punched me in my other eye. And I went home with two black eyes.
Yeah.
And that was the day I became a comedian.
That day.
When I felt like I had nowhere to hide. You know what I mean? I had nowhere to hide, nowhere to go.
Yeah.
So, dude, we have very similar upbringings in a lot of ways.
My dad punished me, like, multiple different ways. You know? It was just, you know, there were belts, there were hands, there were fists. Like,
yeah. You know it was weird? I didn't know it was weird until after I started hanging out with my white friends. Then I went, oh, this isn't normal.
Oh, bro, because all I grew up was white people. And I had white friends.
Yeah.
So when I saw my white friends, especially like 13, 10 years old, like yelling back at their parents and shit.
Oh, my God.
I'm like, yo, this is heaven.
I thought they were going to die. I thought they were going to get killed.
I'm like, you're not, like, I remember, yo, I grew up with these twins, man, Adam and Jonah.
Mm-hmm.
And they, you know, they were like, they would yell back at their mom. They were like, you know, but they never got hit. They never got, like, beaten up, you know. Like, I'm like, I want to be at this house all the time.
Yeah.
Like, I literally want to live at their house because, like, I'm just like, they would stay late, 2:30 in the morning. Their mom wouldn't care. Like,
yeah.
And I'm like, my household is totally different. Like,
yeah.
You know, the thing is, it's weird. Like, my parents, they taught me a lot, but they necessarily, like my dad, he told me what to do. He didn't show me what to do.
Yeah.
You know,
I can relate to that. Yeah.
You know, like, you know, he did as best as he could, but he no one taught him how to be, like, you know, he didn't have a father.
Sure.
He had to be a man at like 10, 12, 13 years old. Like,
yeah.
he had to raise his brothers, you know. His mom, my grandmother, was like a single, like, mom. So I don't blame him, you know, but there's no emotional thing.
Of course,
like,
not. Yeah.
I can't, like, sit down and talk to him.
You understand.
Like,
I mean, you get to an age where you, I remember in my 20s and 30s, I was very angry at my dad. But then when I hit around mid 30s, I'm like, I kind of understood what he went through. And then I'm like, I'm not mad at him anymore. I empathize with him now. I didn't want to empathize before because I just thought he was a mean dude that used to beat me.
I was mad at my dad for a while.
Yeah, me too.
I didn't speak to my dad. I didn't go to Thanksgivings probably for like 6 years.
Wow.
In my 20s.
Wow.
Yeah.
Wow.
Just because, like, you know, when you go to college now you're starting to become, like, you're trying to find yourself, right?
Yeah.
You know, I don't know who I was, but, you know, I'm experiencing things in college. I'm I'm trying different wardrobes. Like you go through many different phases, right?
Sure.
As a young man, as you're trying to find who you really are, and they couldn't understand that.
Yeah.
You know, they wanted me to go on this narrow road, and it brought a lot of, you know, and just, we just didn't really get along, and there was other things happening in the family, and I just was like, you know what, I don't want to be a burden. I'm just gonna stay away.
Yeah.
And I lived, you know, many different places. There was a time I was homeless one time.
Wow.
It's crazy. I was homeless one time, and my parents lived 3.5 miles away.
Get out.
Yeah. I lived in a storage facility.
And you didn't feel comfortable calling them and saying it. Why?
Pride. Just like, you know, it's pride. It's like,
you wanted to say, I can do it on my own.
I want to do it on my own.
You lived in a storage facility?
Yeah, I lived in a storage facility for 4 months.
Wow.
Yeah, I was a manager of a storage facility, and then I would just make. I took the one of the perks was they gave me the biggest unit. I could take any unit I want. Mm. So I was like, well, I'll take the biggest unit. Like, you know.
Yeah.
And I just made my place to stay. I would take showers at the gym. I would have like a $10, $15 membership. I would just go work out, take showers, make sure I take showers, and I would go about 2 o'clock in the morning, 1 o'clock in the morning, sneak in, back in, and just sleep and do that for 2-3 months. Oh no, actually three, four months. I got enough money to get my own apartment. Like,
yeah.
Yeah. So I never was afraid not to, like, I never was afraid of not to do what I need to do.
Exactly.
You know,
you do what you got to do. So speaking of doing what you got to do, what about the happiest time? What do you think has been your best moment so far going through what you went through and how it influenced you as a human being and as a comedian? What do you think has been the best time for you?
The best time was, the best time I would say is probably before I was 12.
Oh, wow.
It was probably before I was 12 when I didn't know, like, what was the reality of, like, who I really was.
Wow.
Because everything was just organic. So it was
when you knew your parents were your parents.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Because everything was, like, you know, we went together. We went to baseball games. I saw my baseball games. We did everything as a family.
Yeah.
And then 12, 13 happened, and it was like, whatever.
You know, they're still your mom and dad, right?
Yeah, yeah, yeah. They are. They are. They are. But, you know, there's definitely, like, it's definitely shaped. Like, it's,
of course,
it's shaped because everything started with me because I'm the oldest of my brothers and sisters. You know, and I have brothers and stepsisters like from I've never met my dad. Ever till this day.
Wow.
Yeah, I never met him. So
how does that feel? How does that affect your version of reality? Does it still affect the way that you feel trust and getting to know people and all that stuff? Not knowing him?
I think when I got into comedy, mm-hmm. before I got into comedy, definitely like I didn't trust people. Like, you know, I definitely wanted to like just be by myself, do what I wanted to do.
Yeah.
And then once I started comedy, I thought I knew everything before I did comedy. But once I started doing comedy, it started heightening I started observing things, the self-awareness. Yeah. And I'm like, oh man, I don't know anything, man.
Yeah. What a gift that is. It sounds like a terrible thing to realize that we don't know anything, but it's actually a gift.
And I'm really, you know, now it's like, oh man, like I'm really like, I really care about making an impact. Like, the one thing I always try to do when I meet people is I try to at least leave them with something for them to remember me by.
Yeah.
You know, like, so it's because the last thing,
you know, you do that, right?
I hope so.
You are.
I hope so.
You know, you are doing that.
Through comedy, you think?
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
I do.
Yeah.
I do. As like a fellow Northeast African, I'm very proud of you. I love when you go up and do your comedy. Like last night, I loved you did great. You closed off a show that had been around for a year, and that show was going to go away because new management.
Yeah.
And they chose you to be the guy to close the show.
Yeah.
And I think you had a really great set, and you had great crowd work, and it was like, I was really proud of you as an African brother.
My man.
To see you go up there and do your thing. It was great.
This is the time where I'm happy. You know, I mean, there's this business. It's ups and downs, and we definitely we have our doubts of ourselves sometimes.
Yeah.
But the happiest time, aside from before I was 12, is for me is right now, because I know, that I can withstand anything this business can give me.
That's right.
Because I've been through some real shit.
That's right.
You ain't going to tell me I can't do anything.
That's
right. You know what I'm saying? Like, that's just, I don't take no for an answer. If, you know, I don't go traditional routes, you know, when I started, like, you know, I had a job and I quit that job, you know, I didn't work for 2 years. I was actually living in LA for like a year, try to, you know, reset myself. And I was like, hey, I want to do comedy now. And then I moved back to Boston, try to get better and do that.
Yeah.
And then 3 years later, I met, about 3 or 4 years in, met Randy, my friend Randy. And, you know, when he came into my life now, and, like, you know, it's like weird how we help each other. We push each other now.
You guys are awesome.
And then we have a podcast. We produce shows, you know.
Ready, Set, Blow.
Ready, Set, Blow podcast. And I just, you know, I love people, you know, and I feel like you could definitely make people feel good if you pay attention.
Yeah, 100%.
And be a curious listener, too.
100%.
That's my thing. Might be a self-awareness and being a curious listener.
That's exactly right. My grandfather used to say, listening is the cost of being heard.
That's a good one.
If you want people to listen to you, you better give them evidence you're willing to listen to them. And I think it's a valuable human transaction that we need to be aware of. But, dude, I thank you so much for being a guest.
I appreciate it, man. Hopefully I didn't talk too much.
Dude, are you kidding me?
That's like the skim like of my
crazy
life.
Crazy-ass immigrant. Hopefully I didn't talk too much. You're on a podcast, you crazy motherfucker.
I know, right?
I brought you on a podcast to speak.
I know, that's right. Hopefully I didn't talk too much.
Dude, you were amazing. This is such an amazing story. It makes me that much more proud of you. You know what I mean? I think you're a great person. You're a great comic.
I appreciate that, bro.
Like, I remember the first time I met you, I'm like, this dude is such a nice guy. I'm suspicious.
Yeah.
I'm suspicious.
Isn't that weird?
Why is he so nice? It's because I was a broken person, too. You know what I mean? Mm. But I was like, but then you said you were a retreat, and I'm like, all right.
You get it.
I'm with him. I'm with now.
Isn't that weird?
And now it's been years, dude. It's been years now. Three, four years, 5 years now.
The one reason why I kind of knew you were a real dude, because, dude, I've gone into trouble as a kid. I've been in gangs as a kid. Like, you know, I skimmed over my life. Trust me. Like, but I've seen real shit. I've almost been shot at. Like, I've been robbed at gunpoint. I've been through some shit. I know I have a really good sense of character with people. I could judge people really well. Mm-hmm. And I was like, yeah, man, this guy can, man. He responds to texts. And it's genuine, man. It's
of course.
It's genuine. And it's like, you know this business, man. You know, it's like some people, they just kind of bypass the time. They'll give you fake answers and stuff.
Yeah.
You always take the time to say, hey, man, how are you doing?
Absolutely.
You know, and a lot of people don't do that. You know, a lot of people's like, well, you know, they want to know what's going on.
What can you do for me?
But you're just like, sometimes we don't even talk about comedy for like 5-10 minutes.
Sure.
It's more of just like, hey, man, what have you been up to?
Well, I'm glad, man. That makes me feel good. I'm really glad.
And you've been doing great, man. You're hustling. And I mean, thanks, you definitely, and I, you know, you're great, man. I think we were talking the other night, man. I was like, dude, like, man, you got a great voice and you got great perspective. And I think as an immigrant, as immigrants, man, you know, we have to share it. We have to bring it.
100%.
We'd be losers, man, like, if we don't tell people, like, our story, man.
100% agree. And it's funny because our story is America's story.
Right.
We are the stars and stripes in that flag. And that's what...
What's the first word in America, man? United.
Exactly. United States of America. And I love the Americans that get that. I love the Americans that realize that what this country has given them is what they've given us. And that just because we are born on a different piece of land doesn't mean that we're not the same.
Oh.
We are the same. We are the same.
And we have lost more people to that stupid rationale than, you know, Ethiopia, Eritrea. Right. Egypt, like, Egypt's gone through some of this stuff. Like,
100%.
When do we just stop, like, thinking like this, man? Yeah. When are we ever going to get to a point where, let me ask you a question. Do you think we're ever going to get to a point where, you know, we're just going to stop this dumb thinking, this old way of thinking?
Yeah. I think.
Might not happen in our past, huh?
Us doing this is what starts to do it.
Right.
You and I and other immigrants and other people, because of this great country, having the courage and the ability and the nerve to go up and tell our stories and to be able to go up on stage and make fans that are of different colors, different nationalities, different race, I think that's what makes a difference.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? That's what will make a difference. And yeah, absolutely. But, you know, it's we have two brains. We have our reptilian brain, that caveman brain we were born with. And then we got new software just added on top, which is the modern brain. And I think our sense of tribalism is always going to be there. But hopefully we'll get past that. Hopefully it'll be better. Hopefully we'll get to a better world. But as far as I'm concerned, as long as there's people like us trying, making the effort.
Straight up.
That's the pursuit of happiness. That's what the Founding Fathers taught me, that the pursuit is better than the actual end game. It's better to pursue happiness than to have happiness. So for me, it's better to pursue equality than to have equality. And as long as people like you and me and Randy and all the other people in any form of minority they're in, whether they're American and gay or whether they're American and left-handed instead of right-handed or whatever way they feel that they've been diminished, as long as they're able to stand up for themselves, and I think that's an important thing to do. That's an important way to make the world a better world and to keep us evolving in the right direction.
Yeah.
So that being said, thank you so much.
No, thank you for having me. For
being on the podcast.
For sure, man.
I was really happy to have you on. I've known you for years.
Yeah.
So it's been really great to finally have you on my podcast.
Hell yeah.
And then is there anything you want to promote so fans can follow you and catch up with you?
Yeah, man. You guys can, you know, follow me. I'm on all the social media craziness that's out there, you know, Instagram, Facebook, Twitter, Snapchat, Instagram at Chase Abel, Twitter at Chase Abel 1, just at Chase Abel, man. And everywhere you can follow me on our podcast, me and my friend Randy, on all the platforms, YouTube, Spotify. We're on all the at Ready Set Blow podcast.
Ready Set Blow podcast. I was their first guest.
Yeah,
so I love that podcast. Yeah. I love it.
We had you on. Yeah, it was great.
That's right.
It's definitely not for the meek, but not for the insensitive. So you better get.
That
know.
Was the craziest episode of any podcast I've ever been on in my entire life.
And we got into it.
We did
right away.
We did.
And you did not hold back one.
I didn't. Yeah. It was like 3 o'clock in the morning. We were drunk and high.
You were in a different space, Belly.
It was right when Trump won. I was a very angry period of my life. But it was fun to get to sit down with friends and just be honest. You know, just be honest with each other. It was great.
It was dope. And we'll continue to do it.
Right on.
Yeah.
And guys, thanks so much for listening to another episode of They Try to Bury Us. Please continue with your reviews and ratings and telling all your friends. You have no idea how much it means to us. If you're looking for live comedy, you can follow me on my new website, TamerKattan.com, on Instagram at Tamer Kat, and on Twitter at Tamer Kattan. And you can also follow my mom on Instagram at kittykattan.com or kittykattan. Thanks so much. And see you guys next time. Thanks a lot. Bye bye.
Fucking bitch.